Hello everyone. Welcome to the Azure Community Conference. In this session, I would be talking to you about GitHub Actions and how they could enable implementing some of the DevOps best practices. My name is Usha. I worked as a product manager for multiple developer and DevOps products, including Azure DevOps, Azure Pipelines, and currently I'm with GitHub in the space of GitHub Actions. In the current environment, remote work has become a mandatory norm. Effective organizations need to find new ways to help their developers code, ship, and continuously deliver value with little to no disruption to their user base. So how are these enterprises able to ship faster while maintaining governance, security, compliance standards amidst this pandemic that has forced all of us to work to be remote? Now, most enterprises actually attribute their success to following DevOps best practices. In this session, we learn about some of the key DevOps challenges and how enterprises follow best practices to address these challenges. Here is the agenda for our session. I will introduce you to the new DevOps platform within GitHub, which is GitHub Actions. And then I'll highlight some of the key DevOps challenges faced by enterprises. One solution reference architecture. And I'll show you lots of demos following that to demonstrate how GitHub Actions can enable some of the DevOps best practices. DevOps unites software development and IT operations into teams aligned to business, product, and customer needs. Now, the end goal of DevOps is to enable organizations to innovate, transform their product ideas to market as fast as possible without really sacrificing the stability or security of their production systems. Let's look at how DevOps is proven to make teams successful. Quality, speed, and efficiency are all the tangible benefits of effectively managed DevOps. We've seen customers practicing DevOps really improve their efficiency. 22% improved quality of their applications. We've seen customers getting faster deployment cycles by 30 to 50 times. Customers practicing DevOps help them take their code from commit to deployment 200 to 400 times. Now that's very significant. It helps them increase their developer velocity, thereby delivering continuous value to their customers. Now, there are many ways to achieve continuous delivery for any given cloud. Say Azure. You could use Jenkins, you could use Azure Pipelines, but in today's session, I will showcase how you could achieve continuous delivery and implement DevOps best practices using GitHub Actions. So, what are GitHub Actions? 50 million developers live on GitHub, working on personal and professional projects. GitHub is the world's largest repository for open source collaborators, and it includes code bases of many businesses. Built directly into GitHub, GitHub Actions supports automating tasks in the GitHub experience, shipping code directly to code in a repeatable and automated process. Announced only a year ago, GitHub Actions has already proven to be a powerful, flexible, and world-class CI/CD platform. Fully integrated with GitHub, you can trigger a job on any GitHub event to automate any workflow to your team. And because Actions is built in, there's no need to manually configure or set up CI/CD, to set up webhooks, to buy your own VMs, patch them, keep them up to date, monitor them, or do any kind of cost management or shut down idle VMs. Just drop a workflow file in your repo and you're up and running. Community is at the heart of GitHub. Anything you build with GitHub Actions is shareable because it's just code in a repo. You can make it public, fork it, edit it, and make it yours. Currently, there are close to 5,900 plus actions published to GitHub Marketplace. You can use these as building blocks to work with any platform, any language, and any cloud. Actions help enterprises enable inner source and accelerate their product innovation by harnessing this collective knowledge around writing secure, scalable, and workflow automation, not just within their organizations, but also from the broader community. What are GitHub Actions for Azure? Now, GitHub has actually partnered with various cloud providers to ensure that teams are able to develop, deliver, and deploy to their cloud provider of choice directly from GitHub repositories. GitHub and Microsoft Azure have partnered to create a huge catalog of simple and consistent actions that can help you to package, release, and deploy apps to Azure from GitHub. There are starter workflows available for popular languages and frameworks. These actions enable you to work with a variety of Azure services, from app services to serverless functions to SQL, MySQL databases. Microsoft Azure has released actions for building, deploying container-based applications that work with Docker, Kubernetes on any environment and cloud, in addition to their managed Azure Kubernetes Service, AKS. Now, GitHub Actions for Azure are also integrated into various developer tools. Various enterprises use GitHub Action integrations and enterprise features like organizational runners, organizational secrets, templates to help their developer teams with best enterprise DevOps capabilities of both GitHub and Azure. Deploying to Azure is quite easy. Often, enterprises and developer teams find it difficult to craft CI/CD pipelines by editing multiple YAML files to stitch code to cloud automation workflows. Teams end up spending considerable time and effort setting up and switching between various discrete tools during their day-to-day development cycles. With integrations for Actions for Azure into various tool extensions like GitHub Portal, VS Code, and also Azure Portal, getting started with Azure Actions has become super easy. In GitHub Portal, you can just go to Actions tab and get started to deploying your Node apps to Azure. From Azure Portal, from AKS Deployment Center experience, as well as Azure Static App Create experience, you could quickly set up any CI/CD workflow targeting those respective Azure services. With that context, let's just shift gears. We just looked at how easy it is to use GitHub Actions to deploy to Azure. However, enterprises don't just look for ease of deployments. They also look to implement best practices. Now, many enterprise organizations adopting DevOps often need to transform their existing people, processes, and technologies. Let's look at some of the key challenges that these enterprises face. The first challenge in the DevOps is, compared to 10 years ago, releases have become super fast. Releases have become 7 times faster if you just compared it to 10 years ago. People are using DevOps practices, have achieved this through code to cloud automation. But the most important thing is reliability. How reliable is your pipeline? How consistent is your pipeline? How much of automation have you done? Now that's very critical for you to innovate faster. The second challenge is security. 62% of enterprises said they don't integrate security into their development phase. They also said they only test security vulnerabilities for a major release or when they're actually releasing to production. In fact, many enterprises do not realize the importance of security until they actually met with an incident. So shift left is a powerful mechanism that can help these enterprises overcome some of these security challenges. Compliance is the next challenge. It takes months for enterprises to realize if their product is fully compliant with the best practices or processes that are defined. For some of the industries like health industry, compliance proves to be very important. Now, how consistently are these enterprises applying the compliance at all stages of their software supply chain is a very important challenge. Governance. Based on the survey, what we've learned is that 86% of enterprises believe remote work is the future. Now, if that's the future, how do you make sure that there is an audit that happens? How do you make sure that there is traceability that's happening across all the products and all the tools that their development teams are using? So consistency becomes a very important challenge. It's actually a governance challenge. Organizations have hundreds of developers working in self-organizing teams. So it's important for them to have consistent implementational practices across their IT landscape. Almost all the enterprises make use of reference architectures with best practice guidance for how to build and run their applications, as well as how to incorporate governance and security. Here is one such solution reference architecture, which shows the development lifecycle with steps. The first one is the dev inner loop. Now, developers would like to use their favorite code editors or IDEs, but what's more important is that there is a dedicated dev environment or a dev cluster that's available to them to continuously code, test, and debug so that this inner loop is very fast. The second one is about whatever code that's getting deployed, is it getting version controlled? From the version control, do we really have automation in terms of build and release pipelines, which can automatically build the code, automatically test your code, and automatically deploy your code? Now, this DevOps pipeline is the code to cloud automation that's very, very important. Number four practices everything as code. Can you store your pipeline as code? Can you store your infrastructure as code? For example, if you are using Azure as a cloud, do you use ARM templates? Can you store your policies as code? Now, when you store all of these as code, you can actually achieve reliability. You can achieve the collaboration among team members, and you can consistently use a pipeline to deploy it. Number five is really about combining the number three, that's everything that you have stored as code, the pipeline, the infrastructure, the application as code, to deploy automatically to all your environments. The dev environment, staging environment, and the production environment. Number six is about policies. How do you define these policies? How can you store these policies as code and apply the same policies across all the development environments, staging and production, so that it's actually consistent all across? Number seven, once your code is in production, have you enabled monitoring and logging? Are you monitoring the health metrics? Are you monitoring the usage metrics? Using these health metrics and usage metrics, you can really validate if your hypothesis and your product or feature that your developers have built is really performing as expected in the market. If not, that's just learning. And you want to take this through the feedback loop, or you would want to talk to these customers and learn what's really working and what's not working for them, what their new requirements are. And then you will go back to your inner loop. So these are the eight different steps that are referenced in this architecture that you can emulate for your code to cloud journey. We have given this reference architecture with GitHub as the source control system, with GitHub Actions as your DevOps pipeline, and Kubernetes as the deployment target. Now, you could target this for any cloud. Well, we are in Azure conference, and so if you are actually targeting Kubernetes, we'd use AKS for your application. So what other tools can you use? You could use Azure ARM templates as your infrastructure and Azure policy as code. So in the next set of demos, I will show you how you could use this reference architecture and how you could address some of the challenges that we had discussed before. All right, let's get into our first demo. In this demo, I would be using the same reference architecture, but would be highlighting three steps in it. The first is a pipeline that we can create for building and testing your application and deploying it to a demo cluster. Second one I want to highlight is that everything is code. How can you store your pipeline as code in GitHub Actions? How can you maintain your infrastructure as code using GitHub? And then we'd use the same pipeline, that's number 5, to provision this infrastructure and deploy your application. Let's jump into the demo.
Here is a simple containerized application which we will deploy to a Kubernetes cluster. If you look at the code, there's a Docker file, then there are manifest files used to deploy to our Kubernetes cluster, and then there are the ARM templates which provision the Kubernetes cluster for our dev, staging, and prod environments. To start with, I want to build a simple action-based workflow which builds this container image, pushes it to the ACI, and then deploys it to our dev cluster. Like I mentioned earlier, it's very easy to get started with GitHub Actions for workflow. Let me show you how. So as you're seeing, there is a good catalog of getting started templates that's already provisioned, that's already shown by the platform here. As you can see, we have a ready template, starter template, which can be used if we were to deploy this Node.js app into an Azure web app. But here, since we want to actually target a Kubernetes cluster, let me just set up a workflow by myself. Since we're looking at Kubernetes deploy, I look for this marketplace search experience, and then I started searching for Kubernetes, and I found this deploy to Kubernetes cluster action. Here, I have the complete signature of the action and the parameters that it takes displayed. Let me just look at more documentation here. This is the Kubernetes deploy action, where it describes all the capabilities that are provided by this action, followed by the inputs that are taken by these actions. We also have example YAML snippets that we could readily copy and use in our workflows. There is also an end-to-end workflow which can build a container image and deploy to a Kubernetes cluster, exactly the use case that we're looking at. So I'll copy this workflow and paste it here. Now that creates the main.yaml, the new workflow file, which actually has steps to log in into the container registry and build and push our container image, which is then deployed into the Kubernetes cluster that we just provisioned in our dev environment. However, let me show you a workflow that I've already created. Here, I don't want to just push this image to my dev cluster. I also want to set up my staging and production clusters into which I want to promote the same artifact, which is the container image that we just built in this build job, and deploy to first dev stage. First, we are provisioning the dev environment, and then the next few steps are to deploy it into the Kubernetes cluster. And the same set of steps are also replicated for the staging environment as well as the production environment. So if you look at our reference architecture, the first demo, we wanted to set up this workflow which actually creates build, deploy, and also provision infra in the form of a code. So GitHub Actions actually help us create such a workflow within very few steps, right? Now, we'll also look at the production cluster where we've actually deployed this code. So this is the Azure portal and the production AKS cluster where we've done this deployment. There is a new integration that we've very recently enabled where we are giving end-to-end traceability from Azure portal all the way into GitHub. So if you actually look at this workloads view, you can see all the deployments that have happened here, including the app that we just deployed. And if you click on change logs and authorize to your GitHub account, then it would even bring the specific commit and issues that have actually got deployed to this cluster. So this is actually an end-to-end traceability view that's built between GitHub portal and Azure portal. So if an IT admin actually wants to look at the specific code diff that got deployed into this cluster in a specific deployment, then he could just get to this view and could easily find out what's this exact code change that got deployed to the cluster, which is actually giving us the end-to-end traceability. And so in this demo, we've actually seen how to build workflows as code, pipeline as code, and we've also seen how we maintain infrastructure as code, and the same pipeline which actually deploys the code, provisions the code and deploys the code to the dev environment is also deploying to our staging as well as production environments. And so if a team needs to collaborate and wants to make any changes, add a new step into any of these environments, could easily do so by adding the same step into all the environments here. And that completes our demo number one. So in the first demo, I have shown you how GitHub Actions can be used to build a simple pipeline as well as a multi-stage pipeline where we could provision the ARM infrastructure as code as well as deploy the app to each of these environments that we have provisioned, dev, staging, and production. With that, let's go to demo number two. Now in the second demo, we are using the same reference architecture. We're now taking the policy, store the policy as code, and use the pipeline to automatically assign the policy to various environments. This is the automation that we want to achieve using Azure Policy and GitHub Actions. Let's jump into the demo. Okay, we are in the Azure Policy view of the Azure portal. So here, we have added a new integration point between Azure portal and GitHub. As you can see, this new menu item called Export Definitions. As we click this, it gives us the complete list of all the repositories that we have access to. We could, in selecting this one repository that I just created, as you can see, it's an empty repository. Once we complete this operation, you will see that the policy would be exported as source code into this repo. Now, when I click next, we get an option to choose the scope. So the policy export can be done at subscription as well as at a specific resource group level. So let me choose the broad resource group into which we have done the deployments. So normally IT folks apply their policies into the broad environments. Now let's add a few policy definitions. So I'm adding a policy called allowed resource locations. Now this is a custom policy that normally IT admins would have already added. And another is, do not allow privileged containers into the Kubernetes cluster. Then I'm adding a third policy. Ensure that only allowed container images are deployed into the Kubernetes cluster. As you can see, we also have an option to either export only the definition or definition as well as assignments. I have chosen definition as well as assignments. Now, once I click on export, in a matter of few minutes, we will have all of these policies exported into our new repo that we have just configured. For the purpose of this demo, I'm showing you a repo where I have done a similar operation. As you can see, the policies are all exported here. There is a policy.json as well as the assignments that have been actually exported here. Apart from the policies, we also had configured workflows that are based upon actions, GitHub actions. So as you can see, there is a deploy policy to prod workflow, which actually deploys these policies into the production environment. One other point to note is normally policies are recommended to be maintained separately from the application code. So we have chosen the separate repo with explicit RBAC that is configured for this repo. One other thing that we could actually benefit from the policy integration with GitHub is that if you go to the definitions here and you search for any of the applied policies, you can actually see the traceability here again. The IT admins could quickly understand who has applied this policy last, right? So this again brings traceability from GitHub portal all the way into the Azure portal. One other thing that most of the IT admins do is to apply the policies first to a test environment. This is to preempt any kind of disruptions on the actual production environment. So they actually apply the policies onto a test environment and ensure that all the expected policies are applied. And then once all the results are positive, we then safely can deploy to production. So these are all best practices in terms of how policy can be managed as code, not just because it gives us a collaboration feature where teams can actually contribute to these policies as code, but also it gives a great reliability and consistency for IT admins to manage these workflows across various environments. Now that completes our demo 2. Let's look at the third demo. We're again looking at the same reference architecture, and let me highlight a few things. The shift left concept to address two specific challenges. One, from the security perspective, how can you shift left in the dev environment and into the dev cycles so that you can catch some of the security vulnerabilities a lot more faster? Similarly, some of the policy assignments, how can you really shift left and achieve the policy automation and catch some of the policy issues early on in the development cycle? So now, let me just shift to the demo. So we are back to the same demo where we were deploying a Kubernetes application to production. What we're trying to do now is, from security perspective, for every code change, how can we make sure that as part of the developer cycle, as part of a pull request, can I do security vulnerability scan? How can we really do a container image scan, right? Make sure that the changes that I'm doing are not really introducing any new vulnerabilities to my production workloads. So that's the scenario that we'll quickly see in this demo. So I click on pull request and look at one of the pull requests that I've created earlier. As you can see, the checks have really failed. And if you look at the details, we see that after the build, there was a container scan that was executed, which actually found 38 vulnerabilities. And hence, this particular PR scan has been canceled. Now, as soon as my PR run fails, I can actually block from this change getting into my master. That's exactly what is shift left of security, that you want to achieve by completely blocking some of these security vulnerabilities from reaching our production workflows. Now, how do I achieve it? If I switch to the action workflows that we have created, earlier we have seen the ci.yaml, which actually provision and deploy our app code across various environments. Now I'm showing you a new YAML called pr.yaml, which actually runs during every pull request that's raised on the master branch. And then anytime we are actually merging into the master, we're actually running this container scan action. This action would scan the container images and identify if there are any new vulnerabilities introduced because of this image and block the execution. This is what helps you shift left and avoid any security issues from getting into the master branch and from there on into the production. But that's just one scenario that I wanted to show you as part of this shift left demo. Now, the second scenario I wanted to show you as part of the shift left is the policy as code scenario. As part of the demo, we saw that IT admins normally assign policies to production, but we could always assign the same policies to dev, staging, and production as well, right? Because our policy is now managed as code, and since we do have workflows that have actions in them, which can easily help us apply those policies to any environment, we can actually take the same policy and apply to any environment, that is dev and staging as well. But how does it help? What scenarios would it solve? Today, most of the times, developer actually does his testing in either a dev environment or a staging environment. For example, one of the scenario is, what resources are you allowed to create? Because of your compliance requirements, you are not allowed to probably create some of the production resources in a different region. Simply block it. Not just that, ensure only allowed container images, or do not allow privileged containers that are getting executed. And simply all of these can be blocked using the policies, because they're applied at production. When you run it, when you take your application from dev to production, sometimes you might just see surprises. Now, if the same policies, if you apply by at dev stage itself, you could do the testing. You could actually see the policies working right from the dev environment and can probably preempt some of those unwanted surprises. So here I have a workflow that can actually apply the policies to dev, staging, as well as production environments. Now, because of the integration that we've done from the Azure portal between Azure policy and GitHub, we could even see who has actually applied these policy assignments and trace it back from the policies applied to dev, staging, and production all the way to GitHub portal. That completes our demos. So I'm really happy that today in this session, we have actually discussed a good number of DevOps challenges and how GitHub Actions could actually help the enterprises overcome some of the challenges. If you want to learn more about how GitHub Actions can actually help code-to-cloud automation with all the best practices, please check out this link, which has a lot of starter templates along with the samples that I have actually discussed in the demos today. And it also lists all of the actions that are available to target deployments on Azure. We also have this other link where you could learn more about the best practices for enterprise-wide DevOps adoption. Thank you for watching this session. It was a great opportunity talking to all of you, and I hope it was useful to learn some of the DevOps resiliency challenges and some of the key best practices that we've discussed today. Hope you have a great time participating at this Azure conference. Thank you so much. Stay safe and stay happy.